Please stand for our opening hymn. Together today to obey that command. Baptism with water signifies the cleansing from sin that Jesus' death makes possible and the new life that God gives us through the Holy Spirit. In baptism, the promises of God are visibly signed and sealed for us. We are joined to Christ and made members of his body, the Church Universal. Children are baptized in response to God's all-embracing love. Parents and godparents who have responded to that love come now to bring this child for baptism. Before this congregation, they must express their own trust and commitment to the promises of God and their intention to bring up their children in the faith and practice of the Church. In due time, Zaya should make his own response to God and be prepared for confirmation. So we welcome you, Zion, with your sponsors and families. We give thanks for you and pray that you may know God's love and faithfulness forever. Let us affirm our trust in God's mercy and confess that we need forgiveness. Let us pray. Lord God, you created this world and made us in your own image. Forgive us when we turn away from you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord God, through your your Son, you overcame evil and death. Rescue us from slavery to sin. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord God, by your Spirit, you restore us to fellowship with you and with one another. Breathe your love and freedom into our lives. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you your sins, and keep you in life eternal. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The prayer of the day, let us pray. Ever-living God, your Son, Jesus Christ, healed the lepers and brought good news to the despised and outcast. Grant us your gifts of compassion and self-control, that in serving others in their need, we may strive for the imperishable wreath that you bestow on all who truly love you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated for the Liturgy of the Word.
Psalm is Psalm 30. I will read it in alternate verses. I will exalt you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up from the depths.
And have not suffered my foes to triumph over me.
Just a minute. Mine's got different bits involved. Okay. Lord my God, I cried to you, and you have made me whole.
You brought me back, O Lord, from the land of silence. You saved my life from among those who go down to the pit.
Sing praises to the Lord, all you his faithful ones. Give thanks to his holy name.
For if in his anger is habit, in his good favour is life. Heaviness may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning.
In my prosperity I said, I shall never be moved. Your goodness, O Lord, has set me on so firm a hill. Then you hid your face from me, and I was greatly dismayed.
I cried to you, O God, and made my petition humbly to my Lord.
What profit is there in my blood if I go down to the pit? Can the dust give you thanks or declare your faithfulness? Hear, O Lord, and be merciful. O Lord, be my helper. You have turned my lamentation into dancing. You have put off my sackcloth and girded me with joy, that my heart may sing your praise and never be silent. O Lord my God, I will give you thanks forever.
Second reading comes from St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 9, verses 24 to 27. Do you not know that in a race the runners all compete, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win it. Athletes exercise self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable garland, but we an imperishable one. So I do not run aimlessly, nor do I box as though beating the air, but I punish my body and enslave it, so that after proclaiming to others, I myself should not be disqualified. Hear the word of the Lord.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
Moved with pity, Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, I do choose, be made clean. Immediately the leprosy left him and he was made clean. After sternly warning him, he sent him away at once, saying to him, see that you say nothing to anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest, and offer for your cleansing what Moses commanded, as a testimony to them. But he went out and began to proclaim it freely and to spread the word, so that Jesus could no longer go into a town openly, but stayed out in the country. And people came to him from every quarter. For the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. All today's readings deal in some way with the physical body. In the New Testament reading from the first letter to the Corinthians, Paul compares the life of discipleship and his own ministry to the rigorous training of an athlete and its need for discipline and self-control. The Bible gives great importance to the physical, the material, and the tangible. 28 years ago, the church I was leading went through the long and arduous process of relocating, which involved selling the old church, purchasing land, and then building on the new site. The old church was decommissioned and converted into a chemist by the pharmacy company that bought it. An article and photograph in the local paper said something like, "The building that has for so long been dedicated to caring for souls is about to become a pharmacy caring for bodies." Well, that may have a catchy ring to it as a headline, but it also reflects a common misunderstanding that God and the church and the Bible and religion are concerned exclusively with something called the spiritual life. That way of thinking can end up separating life into compartments. The spiritual compartment is then relegated to a private realm detached from the rest of life. It has resulted in a negative view of the body and sexuality. It's led to the idea that my material possessions and my money belong to me, and I'm free to do with them as I please. It's also given support to the idea that religion has no bearing on politics, economics, and other areas of public and civic life, an idea that suits the powers that be very nicely. God created a material universe, not a world of disembodied spirits. He stood back with great satisfaction and said, "This is very good." He created the human body and pronounced it very good. God created plants and animals and stars and planets and pronounced them good. C.S. Lewis said, "God likes matter. He created it." Many of Jesus' parables and teachings have material and political implications. Many of the Old Testament laws have to do with the human body and how it's treated. Jesus healed physical bodies. He restored physical sight and hearing and even life itself. He was born a physical human being of a human mother, died on a wooden cross, rose a physical though transformed body from the grave. Even the Holy Spirit was manifested physically as a dove at Jesus' baptism and at Pentecost as tongues of fire. The church has a history of caring for bodies as well as minds and souls. It has established hospitals and educational institutions. It has clothed the naked, fed the hungry, and cared for prisoners. The church has continued to the health of the whole person and needs to continue to do so, or where it ceased to do so, to reclaim that role. We are made in such a way that our whole being is affected for good or ill by the experiences of life. Our spiritual, psychological, and mental well-being affects our physical well-being, and vice versa. Good therapeutic approaches treat the whole person. Every aspect of the church's life is expressed or manifested physically. Far from being concerned only with the spiritual, each facet of our purpose and mission and common life is demonstrated in some physical way. It's seen in the church's worship. Worship that is Christian is a physical as well as a spiritual activity. We worship God, whom we cannot see, in spirit and in truth, but through the incarnate Christ, who was born of a woman as flesh and blood. The flesh, our body, is the vehicle of the spirit. English Bishop Michael Marshall, who was in this diocese some years ago now, says spiritual worship is always clothed in matter and expressed in and through the world of flesh and blood. Art, architecture, music, movement, and gesture are all employed in worshipping God. The use of matter, water, oil, bread, wine, candles, precious metals, fabrics, incense, ashes is employed in our worship. Worship involves our whole being, heart, soul, mind, and body. In the New Testament reading, St. Paul tells us to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is our spiritual worship. Sorry, that wasn't from our reading, but it was another part of St. Paul in the book of Romans. The spiritual is expressed through the material. The man who was healed was told by Jesus to go and make a physical and visible act of worship as a sign of thanksgiving. It's also seen in our witness. Often, witnessing to our faith in Christ has been thought of exclusively as a matter of words. To be sure, telling the good news of what God has done for us in Christ is vital. But when Jesus commanded us to love our neighbour and was asked, "Who is my neighbour?" he answered with the parable of the Good Samaritan. That was primarily about action. In the parable of the sheep and the goats, the criterion for entering the kingdom of heaven is the way people treat others physically, the prisoners, the naked, the hungry, the sick. St. James says in his letter, "If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill,' and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that?" In his great commission to his disciples, Jesus said, "Go into all the world and proclaim the good news to the whole creation. The one who believes and is baptized will be saved, but the one who does not believe will be condemned." Go. That is a physical act. The verbal act of teaching is accompanied by making, another action word, making disciples and baptizing them, a physical act. The man with leprosy was commanded by Jesus to go show yourself to the priest and to make the required offering so others could see. They're all physical acts that were to be seen by others as a testimony or witness. And thirdly and finally, related to this is the church's welcome. In a former parish, we had a welcoming training afternoon every so often and took an inventory of how we welcome visitors in particular. We emphasised that relying on welcoming techniques is inadequate and even useless unless the person welcoming is genuinely motivated by the love of God and a love for people. And this is not something you can fake. We ran a series of studies on Benedictine hospitality with its emphasis on making space for others. And of course, that begins by making space in our hearts and minds first. Some of the chapters of the book that we used was Hospitality Begins Inside. In Jesus' day, lepers were not only physically sick, they were forbidden by the law to be touched. As a leper, you would be excluded from contact with other people, even in a religious gathering like this. You were physically, ritually, and even morally unclean. He said to Jesus, "If you choose, you can make me clean." To approach Jesus was to break the law, to cross the boundary between clean and unclean, pure and impure. His crying out to Jesus was not just a cry for healing, but to be readmitted to human society, to be accepted, and so to be fully human again. Jesus then broke the law himself by physically touching the man. "I do choose, be made clean." The man was in a sense moved from death to life. Jesus had restored his humanity, and this is our job, this is our task as the Church of Christ, continuing the reconciliation of the cross and resurrection through our worship, witness, and work. That can only be done through the vehicle of these wonderful instruments we call human bodies. We baptize, and will baptize in a few moments, a new baby, hardly a baby anymore, but a new member into the body of Christ. We come to receive Christ under the material elements of bread and wine. And, like the man in today's gospel, we are healed and reconciled, and our humanity is restored. So we will. It's amazing how when you've got something different, it just throws you completely. So we welcome Zaya, who comes to be baptized. I invite his sponsors to present him now.
We present Zaya to be baptized.
Will you accept the responsibilities placed upon you in bringing this child to baptism? Are you willing to answer on behalf of Zaya? By your prayers and example, by your friendship and love, will you encourage this child in the life and faith of the Christian community?
Yes.
I will with God's help.
Before God and this congregation, you must affirm that you turn to Christ and reject all that is evil. Do you turn to Christ?
I turn to Christ.
Do you repent of your sins?
I repent of your sins.
Do you reject selfish living and all that is false and unjust?
I reject it all.
Do you renounce Satan and all evil?
I renounce all his evil.
Almighty God, deliver you from the powers of darkness and lead you in the light of life to his everlasting kingdom. Amen. Will you, by God's grace, strive to live as a disciple of Christ, loving God with your whole heart and your neighbour as yourself until your life? Now I address all the others here today. You have heard these, our brothers and sisters, respond to Christ. Will you support them in this calling? Let us pray. Grant, merciful God, that Zion may be so baptized, so buried with Christ in baptism, that the new nature may be raised up in him. May the fruit of your Spirit grow and flourish in him. Amen. Give to his sponsors the desire to share with him what you have revealed in your holy gospel. Amen. May he know Christ's forgiving love and continue in the fellowship and service of his church. May he proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ. Amen. We thank you for the ministry we have in your world and to each other in the household of faith. Hasten that day when the whole creation shall be made perfect in Christ. Amen. I invite you all to stand now, and if you just turn around and face the font, that's where the rest of this portion of the service will take place. And you can just watch them, and you just might wait here until the end of the crossroads. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks that at the beginning of creation your Holy Spirit moved upon the waters to bring forth light and life. With water you cleanse and replenish the earth. You nourish and sustain all living things. Thanks be to God. We give you thanks that through the waters of the Red Sea you led your people out of slavery into freedom and brought them through the River Jordan to new life in the land of promise.
Thanks be to God.
We give you thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, for his baptism by John, for his anointing with the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God.
We give you thanks that through the deep waters of death, Jesus delivered us from our sins and was raised to new life in triumph.
Thanks be to God.
We give you thanks for the grace of the Holy Spirit, who forms us in the likeness of Christ and leads us to proclaim your kingdom.
Thanks be to God.
And now we give you thanks that you have called this your servant to new birth in your church through the waters of baptism. Pour out your Holy Spirit in blessing and sanctify this water so that those who are baptized in it may be made one with Christ in his death and resurrection. May they die to sin, rise to newness of life, and continue forever in Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we give you praise and honor in the unity of the Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
I now ask you to affirm as yours the faith of the Church. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in God the Son,
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
This is the faith of the Church.
This is our faith. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Isaiah, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Getting a bit agitated because I mucked up his hairstyle. I sign you with the sign of the cross to show that you are marked as Christ's own forever. Live as a disciple of Christ, fight the good fight, finish the race, keep the faith. We say together, confess Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, look for his coming in glory. Isaiah, God has brought you out of darkness into his marvellous light. Shine as a light in the world to the glory of God the Father. God has called you into his church. We therefore receive and welcome you as a member with us of the body of Christ, as a child of the one heavenly Father, and as an inheritor of the kingdom. I invite you to put your hands together as we welcome the newest member of the family. And now we share the greeting of peace. In baptism, God has made us one in Christ.
His Spirit is with us.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Now let us share God's peace with one another, with those who are at peace.
Thank you.
have these gifts to share, accept and bless and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom.
Blessed be God.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. All glory and honour be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God. We give you thanks and praise for our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. In baptism, you have united us to him and brought us out of darkness into light. You pour your Spirit upon us, filling us with your gifts and calling us to serve you as a royal priesthood. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Merciful God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and wine, and we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, we do as our Saviour has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Renew us by your Holy Spirit. Unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise. Blessings and honour and glory in Christ are yours forever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray.
Thank you.
who are many are one body.
For we all share in one bread.
Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us your peace. The gifts of God for the people of God. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Any baptized Christian member of any denomination is welcome to receive Holy Communion with us this morning. If you prefer to come forward just for a blessing, would you please just place your hands behind your back and you will be given words of blessing. Thank you. Gracious God, in baptism you make us one family in Christ your Son, one in the sharing of his body and his blood, one in the communion of his Spirit. Help us to grow in love for one another and come to the full maturity of the body of Christ. Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise.
Peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.